I guess we're going to be starting. Do you know this guy? This is Cecil DeMille. And he is the source of the quote that a movie should start with an earthquake and then the tension should rise. So I'm going to start with running this and showing you this. Okay. So we're done. So if you want to know why this doesn't really work, you have to stay the full hour. Hi, I'm Jan. I work at this small company called Duxboard, and I'm going to talk about estimating query progress, so like getting to that part I just showed. If you want to follow the slides on your laptop, this is where you can get them. If you want to try the code, this is where you can get it, and this is more or less how you run it. There's a more verbose README in the repository. This needs a modified Postgres, a slightly modified Postgres. I'll go through the changes I had to add towards the end of the talk. But like, this is just for future reference. So first I'm going to more or less say what the problem is and how would you go about estimating query progress. Then I'm going to try to split my talk. Is this working, right?
Yeah. Okay.
Then I'm going to split my talk between the theory of how it should work and how like scientific papers say it should work, and practice, which means what happens when you try to apply those papers to real life Postgres, which is like hitting a brick wall, more or less. So the problem statement. The problem is fairly simple. Should I kill it yet? So like, I have a query and it's been running for 5 hours. I'm getting angry calls. The I/O is saturated. The CPU is dying, and I should either hit Control C or not. What should I do? I mean, should I ignore the calls for half an hour more and then get the result, or should I cancel it because it's going to take 5 days more? So this is the problem that this is trying to solve. To be more precise, you don't know anything. I mean, Postgres by default will not tell you anything about how far the query is in progress. It's like binary. It's not finished or it is finished. It is hard to decide in general how long will a query take. I mean, you can try to run explain, look at the cause. You can try to do some things, but in general, it's really hard to say how long a query will take before you actually run it to completion. And if you have to take this decision, it is uninformed. I mean, you have to just take a chance. And so while the use case is straightforward, I mean, simple. It's like, should I kill it yet? It's not that simple when you try to think about it more. So if you want an estimator, it's going to give you something. It's like a way to get something out of the system, which could be a number that says how much work is done yet in an abstract way that would need defining. How much work is completed, like between 0 and 100%? How much time is remaining? How much time you need to wait before it's done? And then there's this little problem that the backend that's actually running the query is busy running your query. So you need to somehow go and take that information from inside that process and relay it to the outside. And there are a few more hurdles that I will cover in the hurdles section. So what makes a good estimator? What would you like to get from an estimator? These are four properties I found. I think they're quite descriptive. So you would like the estimator to be monotonous. I don't know if you ever, I mean, think about the download progress. It's monotonous because usually you always get more and more bytes downloaded. You wouldn't want an estimator that goes back because this is confusing. So monotonicity. Granularity, that's an important thing because you have progress estimation right now in Postgres. It goes between 0 and 1 when it's done. But it's not that useful if it's not granular. So you want the estimates to be different in across small time increments. So you want them to change while time progresses, and fairly often. You obviously don't want to don't want progress calculation to have a large overhead, because if it's like doubles the cost or the time of running your query, just as tracking that progress, it's not really worth it. And you'd like the estimates to be independent of the system it's running on, so you wouldn't like the progress to, so you wouldn't want it to progress faster on faster machines and slower on slower machines. You'd like it to be abstracted from the actual speed of the execution. Like, it's like a download counter, a progress bar, is not network independent. It goes fast when you have a fast network and slow when you have a slow network. But a good estimator would not be affected by changes in the underlying system speed. So this is the part where I start talking about the theory, like how ideally this would work in the model that I set out to implement. So I'll start with how to model work that a query does. So what would you call work in a query? I'll start with a brief wade through how the executor works, because we will be working with the executor subsystem. Like a very simple, just for you to get a basic understanding of the concepts and the terminology I'm going to use. So the executor uses a tree structure. This tree is a mirror of the plan tree. So like when you do explain, you see a plan tree. The executor has a mirror of the tree, and the nodes from one tree and the other tree are linked together. So it's actually, you can think of it as one tree, but I'll be using the term executor tree a lot. But it's, so like when you do explain analyze, you see these two trees superimposed, right? Like the plan tree and the execution tree. One gives you the times after execution. One gives you the estimates, which is what the planner put in its tree. Each node of the execution tree produces tuples and has a method that says, give me the next tuple. This method either returns the tuple or returns null if there are no more tuples to be returned from that node. So actually, executing the plan is very simple. You just call this function on the root node of the tree until there are no more tuples. And every time you get a tuple, you emit it to whoever is receiving them, like the client that's connected. Right? So the executor is fairly simple in its in the way it works. And then that's more or less it. So how does a node execute? This generic method of fetching a tuple from the node is actually specialized for each node. So each node has its own way of producing tuples, right? And a sequential scan node would produce a tuple by fetching the next bunch of bytes from the disk and forming a tuple and returning it. A sort node is a bit different. What a sort node would do is when you ask it for the first tuple, it actually reads all the tuples from its downstream node, sorts it, and then gives you the first one. And then when you ask it for the second one, it gives you the second one, and so on. A material node is a bit different again, because what it does, for instance, is it fetches one tuple from the node that's downstream of it, but it retains it in memory. It returns it to the caller, but it returns it the reference to the data in memory, so you can consult it again without executing the fetch method of the downstream node. And all kinds of nodes Postgres can generate, or like all kinds of execution nodes that are there have their own method to fetch to return a tuple, and usually it involves fetching tuples from downstream nodes or reading disk files if it's a sequential scan or an index scan. The nodes have additional data attached to them that get updated while the query is running. And we will use these counters to estimate progress. And like I said, each executor node has a link to the plan node, and plan nodes have planner estimates, where the planner said, I think this will return that many tuples. So here's an example. This is an execution tree for a query. right? That's on the top level, it's a nested loop join. And what the executor will do is it will repeatedly ask this node for a tuple. And when it returns null, it will say, OK, that's all. Now, this node, because it's a nested loop node, when asked for a tuple, will fetch one tuple from the inner child. So it will ask, OK, give me a tuple. Then this guy will say, OK, I'm an index scan. So I will just go to the index, fetch the index entry, then go to the heap, fetch the actual tuple, and return it. It returns it here. Then execution continues with the outer child, which will be then scanned to find the matching tuple for the join condition. And then once this is done, one tuple will be returned, and so on and so on and so forth. Right? So more or less, it's a recursive process where you just ask this guy, and then he delegates work to all the other nodes. Most of what I'm going to show you in the theory section and big parts of what I'm going to show you in the practice sections is based on this paper. So this is kind of like a fundamental paper that has citations in all the other work about progress estimation. So I just wanted to put this out just so you know that what I'm going to show is not really my ideas. It's just these guys' ideas that I'm going to try to kind of digest for you and then show you how implementation of this would look like. So model of work. How do we model the work that needs to be done? We do this through the number of tuples that will be returned across all execution nodes. So we tie progress to the number of tuples returned. No, not the number of bytes processed, not the CPU time spent or CPU ticks or anything like that. We use the number of tuples that will be returned. And the paper calls this the get next model. The get next is actually precisely this. So fortunately, the Postgres execution method is similar to what these guys say that their model will be. So the concepts kind of match. Right, so Postgres calls it differently, but get next is like the basic operation, and the progress will be the number of get next calls across the entire executor tree. And the query is completed, well, all nodes have had get next called up to the point where no more nodes will be produced. Right, so the estimator we will use is this. It's the sum, so for at any given moment, the progress of the query is the sum of tuples that have been returned divided by the sum of tuples that will be returned at the end. So I'm gonna call one of those n, one of those k. So k will be the tuples that have already been returned by one of the nodes for like m nodes. Then n is going to be the number of tuples that will be returned in total. And this looks fine and dandy, but how the hell do you estimate? I mean, k is fairly easy, right? Each time you return a tuple, you just add a counter. That's kind of simple. But n is the hard part. So the challenge actually is how do you estimate how many tuples will be returned from an execution node? Once you have that, you calculate that number. So so GNM is the get next model estimator. It's gonna be here from time to time. So like, that's just so you won't get confused by the acronym. So what's good about GNM? It is kind of computable in Postgres. So that's a start. The models kind of match. Get next is more or less what the executor does. It looks simple enough, the definition at least. It's usually monotonous. I mean, because this number will be should be in theory just a number that this is going to be the number of tuples a node will return, and this number will grow. So this should be monotonous. It's quite fine grained because you usually have quite a few tuples return, and so. There's and tuples are are getting processed all the time. So it's not like it's gonna stall and then only jump up. You can use a lot, like reuse a lot of the infrastructure that Postgres already has, like estimates for the nodes, like instrumentation for the plan for the executor that is used by explain analyze that tells you how many tuples are already processed. All that is already done inside Postgres, so we can work off that. But as we know, the planner can estimate in various ways, which are not always correct. So there are some things that will be challenging here. Now, this looks simple, and it's not useful in its simple form, because basically of the estimates the planner does, which can be very, very wrong. If you would just do the naive thing and calculate GNM directly, like at an even moment, look at the execution tree, add up the tuples returned, add up planner estimates and divide, you wouldn't get a very good estimator. This is where the concept of an execution pipeline appears. So a pipeline is, the definition is that it's a maximal subtree of the executor plan that executes concurrently, which means that it's all of the nodes that will be asked about for a tuple when the root of the pipeline needs to produce one. I'm gonna go back to the slide once we go through the example. It's gonna be a lot more clear. So how do you deconstruct the tree into pipelines? So the leaves, which are usually sequential scans, index-only scans, start new pipelines. So this is where a pipeline starts. Nodes that are blocking, which means that they need to read their input completely before progressing, start a new pipeline. And joins combine pipelines of their children. So this is an example of the previous executor tree with pipelines with pipeline annotations. So this is pipeline 0, pipeline 0, pipeline 0. Actually, this is all one pipeline. And why is that? Because these start a new pipeline, right? Then this is a loop. So this is a join, so it joins these two pipelines. This is yet another pipeline, but here's a join, so it joins these two pipelines. And the same happens here. So actually, this tree is a single pipeline. And it kind of makes sense, right? When you ask this node for a tuple, it will ask this node and this. This will ask this and that, and so on and so forth. So each time you ask for a tuple in the root node, it will execute every node in the tree. So it's like a single pipeline. Here's an example of a tree with two pipelines, just so you know that there can be more pipelines. There can. So here I have a nest loop between an index-only scan and a hash join. And what the hash join does is one of the children is a sequential scan, and the other one is always a hash node. And the hash node, when you ask it for a tuple, will completely drain its child tuple, and only then start returning. Actually, it won't directly return a tuple, because this is where Postgres does something a bit outside of the getNext model. But you can think about it this way. It'll drain this node, and then provide hash join with information it needs to match tuples coming from the node it'll scan and the other subtree. Right, so like I said, a hash is a new pipeline. So these are pipelines. This concept is not very, So parameters or scans that are parameterized are a pain and are not really, so the in In the theoretical model of the paper, they don't consider them at all. There's no word about being able to scan a node several times. So yeah, this will be fairly off. Materialize, no. Materialize, I had a bug when I treated materialize as a new pipeline before I read the code. And actually, no, materialize, like I said, will ask the downstream node for a tuple, return it, but it will not drain it completely. So it's executing concurrently. The tree underneath materialize is executing concurrently with the tree above materialize, with the rest of the nodes. There's a problem with materialize. Yes, but it's not a new pipeline. At least, I mean, in the paper, they only consider scans and three kinds of joins. Like merge join, hash join, and nest loop join. going outside from there, I had to improvise. So this might be wrong, like what I assumed about materialize, about other kinds of nodes that are not mentioned in the paper. So we have pipelines, and there's another concept we need, which is driver nodes. So each pipeline has a set of driver nodes, and driver nodes are basically leaf nodes of this pipeline, except ones that are in the outer tree of the nested loop join, so the tree that gets executed for each tuple of the inner subtree. So you can think about driver nodes as, well, the nodes that drive the pipeline. The ones that are supplying the whole pipeline with tuples that then get processed. And this definition more or less captures that. Now, driver nodes are important for a pipeline because they're better suited to estimate how far along a pipeline is than just looking at all the nodes, because they're driving the pipeline. When they're done, the pipeline should more or less be done. And because they're usually low in the tree, you can get better estimates about this n number, the number of tuples to be produced, and so your error is smaller. So the grayish nodes here are actually driver nodes, right? So when you start to deconstruct this tree, you have four driver nodes, like all the leaf nodes, but then because this node is in the outer subtree of a nest loop, it is not a driver node. And same for this. And so you're done. You end up with only one driver node. And it also kind of makes sense because it's a nest loop, right? So when you finish scanning the inner relation, well, you're done. And for each scan of for each tuple from the inner relation, you execute all that. So basically, this node is driving the pipeline. Just bear with me, and then we'll come to the implementation. Then you will see that there are issues there. So this is a plan with two pipelines. This is the driver node, just because it's a leaf node, and then this is not a driver node because it's in the outer subtree of a nest loop. And this is a driver node because it's just a simple pipeline of two nodes. And yet again, this is interesting. So you have a nest loop. So this, the outer subtree will not have driver nodes. And you have a merge join. And this merge join is getting fed by two index scans. And they are both driver nodes with our definition. And it actually kind of makes sense because they both are driving the pipeline, right? They both are supplying work to the rest of the pipeline. So you can have more than one driver node per pipeline. And this brings us to DNA, driver node estimator, which is what we are going to be actually using and what the paper proposes. The whole idea is based on what they call driver node hypothesis, which just says that. If the ratio between tuples a pipeline has produced and the pipeline is to produce is estimated by the same ratio for the driver nodes, right? So like, let's go back here. They say that the ratio of the number of get next calls across this pipeline divided by the number of calls that this pipeline will do when it's run to completion is approximated by how far along this node is. So how many tuples have this produced and how many tuples will this produce. So that's quite intuitive, right? It's like the driver node is supplying work for the whole pipeline. If I know how far along the driver node is, I know how far along the whole pipeline is. So I will not calculate the get next estimator across the entire pipeline. I will only calculate this for my driver nodes. And so that's the equation. Now this is for pipelines that are in progress. So pipelines that are being executed, being fed. For pipelines that have finished, they say, and it's obvious, the tuples that are returned are equal to the tuples that will be returned in total because the pipeline is done. So we have now returned all the tuples. So if a pipeline is finished, we're really good. We don't need to calculate n for this pipeline because we just take k. And k is precise because we know it, because we actually counted each and every tuple as it came through the pipeline. Now, for pipelines that have not started to be executed, what we do is we know tuples return in nodes of that pipeline is zero, and we use the planner estimate for tuples that are to be returned. This is what the paper mandates. So there's a distinction: pipelines that are in progress, pipelines that are finished, pipelines that have not started yet. And this is all fine and dandy in theory, but in Postgres, a node can run and then be run again. It's hard to even say when a pipeline is actually finished. So this also is not that trivial when you actually go and try to do this in practice. But like, definition-wise, this is what we would do. And so the thing we want to calculate is actually the tuples returned for each pipeline and tuples that will be returned by each pipeline, divide that. Right? So we break it down by pipelines, we estimate each pipeline separately, and we get this. And actually, all the equations you saw, I typeset it like this, and then someone told me, this is a honking bad idea. And so I just left it here for you to see what this talk could have been if someone wouldn't have talked me out of doing, like, using mathematical notation for everything. Bad idea. So we now have a definition. We can just go and implement that. That's cool. So let's go and implement that. The basic idea when I started was first calculate pipelines, identify driver nodes. We already saw that there are some issues there with rescans and so forth. But this is, okay, you can try and do that. So you start and you have the execution tree and you also have pipelines calculated, that's cool. Then when you need to calculate progress actually, you walk all the pipelines and you calculate the k and n numbers for everyone, for each one of them. That's good. Then you divide, and then you're done. And actually, you also take advantage of the fact that you walked the whole executor tree. What I did is I also graphed, like, save snapshots of the tree to see as it progresses. And I'm going to show you one of those. So actually, this is what the tool produces. This is one of the trees that you saw in the on the slides. It's annotated with pipelines. It's annotated. It's grayed out for driver nodes, and it says how many tuples have been produced, how many tuples are to be produced when it's done. And it goes and it goes and it goes. There's a snapshot every now and then because the tool does sampling, blah, 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 and then it's done. And this is the last snapshot. Yes, there is a problem with material nodes, as you can see. The nice thing about DNA is that it doesn't matter, because we use driver node estimator, so we only look at driver nodes while it's executing. So that's kind of manageable. But yeah, this is the kind of animation you can get with the tool. Yes, the planner kind of, well, it wasn't his best day, let's say, but.
this one would have gotten to about, halfway.
You might have noticed and not said anything because you're courteous, but it actually will, like, stop now.
Yeah. Oh, that's horrible. We should have
So that's how I wrote it down in a little file when I started. This is a lot of text, so let's do the same with code. The routine that's most important is processing one pipeline. For each pipeline, you calculate K and N, and then you're done. So first of all, for each node of that pipeline, you see how many tuples have been processed, how many tuples the planner has estimated. Then if all the driver nodes of that pipeline are already done, I assume this pipeline is done. And then I return k as n, right? Because the number of tuples it will return is equal to the number of tuples it has returned. If none of the driver nodes has even started yet, if any of the driver nodes has started, I assume this pipeline is currently running. So it's already producing tuples. And then, well, I return k as k, like tuples processed, that's straight from the counters we update while it's running. And then if you work through the math, that's not very difficult. You will see that n for this pipeline would be k this is wrong, right? Because this is not the global k. This is k for, no, it is the global k. So this is where it's a bit tricky. DNA says that the ratio between tuples processed and tuples to be processed is the same for the whole pipeline and just for the driver nodes. But I want stats for the whole pipeline, not just for driver nodes, because otherwise I would misrepresent this pipeline in the grand scheme of things, right? I would only return the K number for the driver node, and this would be wrong. I need the K number for the whole pipeline. So what I do is I return K, which is the number of tuples processed by the entire pipeline, and if I multiply it by that proportion for the driver nodes, I will get my estimate for the whole pipeline. Right, I also had a bug that, and I actually just wanted to introduce it again right now, because you have to think about how, yes?
Oh, I'm sorry, you can tell me if you're going to cover this later, but when pipelines start and when they finish, there are discontinuities in that end, right? Between the planner's estimate and your actual number of tuples?
Discontinuities, what do you mean? Okay, yeah. So when it starts, so when it hasn't started yet, you use the planner estimate. As soon as it starts, you switch to DNA. So there is this moment where you can have this cliff or this switch, like you said.
Can that break
monotonicity? I believe it can. I believe it cannot, but I would have to think about it a bit more. Yeah, but then. There can be a jump, but can it break monotonicity? I'm not sure. I'm gonna have to think about it a bit. Thing is, pipelines usually start fast. Well, okay, no, maybe not. But yeah, there is this problem like you said, it is the switch is and actually, I'm going to cover that in a bit, but the paper accounts for a way to mitigate that. Right. So if it's not finished and if it hasn't started, it hasn't started, right? So then you say zero for tuples processed and n, the planner estimate for tuples to be processed. So okay, that's kind of simple. Another problem I need to solve was how to grab that estimate out of the backend that's running the query and have it available for other backends. And I went through shared memory. And actually, Simon floated a patch on hackers that allowed people to add a hook on SIG user. So like you can add a hook in your extension, and then when you signal the backend saying, I'm sending you the signal and this is the hook type signal, it will then run your code. And it's a very simple patch. I used it because I needed some way to actually go to have a backend that's busy doing stuff, give some results out. And what happens is that the backend, when it gets this signal, sets a little flag, and the next time it has a break to check interrupts, it will calculate the progress, stuff it in shared memory, and then it's available for other backends from there. What this also means is that if you want estimates, you don't actually get them. You ask for them, and then once the backend that's running the query gets around to servicing your signal, you will be able to grab that. But usually this is almost immediate, because we do check interrupts fairly often. It's like at the same point you would be able to cancel a query, it will calculate the actual progress. So it's a way, if it's ideal, I don't know, but I wasn't really concerned, because you can change that if the estimation works, there will be a way to get it out of the backend. So it's a way as good as another. And then I had to do some changes to core Postgres. And then here's a rundown from the least to the most controversial. The least controversial by far is that most of the code is an extension and it's not in core. So the changes in core are actually quite small and probably kind of acceptable, like half of them. So I needed to stash some private data in the executor tree. So the planner can already, user code from extensions can add private data to the planner tree so we can retrieve it later. The executor tree did not have that feature. I just added it, but it's just like a pointer that you can put stuff in memory for future reference, so that's not a big deal. I needed to augment instrumentation that's being done when a query is run. But there's just allowing the user to control what happens on instrumentation invocation. And this hook on signaling a backend, which I think I can see immediately why it's dangerous, but if you say signal and not dangerous in one sentence, it's probably wrong. So that looked like something simple and manageable, and then you start writing stuff. There are things that were not accounted for by the paper, like a node can have multiple driver nodes, and they actually give examples of pipelines like that in the paper. They gloss about that when they get to actually defining DNA. So no one actually told me how to estimate, how to use a driver node estimator for a pipeline with multiple driver nodes. I just said, oh, you take the first, you take the driver node and you divide the tuples processed by planner estimate and you're done. But with multiple, it's not that simple. Nodes can have more than two children. Like when you have a plan with append, you can have more than, so you don't only have joins that have multiple children, you have lots of stuff that has multiple children. And then there's a whole slew of stuff that's really weird, like scans on functions, like recursive queries, like really weird stuff that no self-respecting paper author would address. And And so you have to deal with that somehow. And rescans would enter this as well. And then the planner can sometimes be quite off. So some of these I was able to kind of solve, or at least come up with something that is maybe usable. Like if you have more than one driver node, I assumed k, so the number of tuples to be returned, to be the average of all the driver nodes. Right? It can be the sum, actually. Well, it could be the sum, right? But why average? Because when you have a merge join, which is a typical example of something with multiple driver nodes, it will stop as soon as one of the inputs runs out, right? So what it is, I said, okay, like more or less, if you would kind of mash these driver nodes together, let's say more or less on average, this is how far they've progressed together. Like just take the average, and then the number of tuples that will be returned, I took the minimum because it's for merge join. This is the right thing to do, kind of, because you say the number of tuples that will be the number of get next calls that will be done is the minimum across both merge join nodes. It was just something to, this is so isolated that if someone has a better idea of how to deal with multiple driver nodes, it's just easy to change. But this got me running at least. Now, an annoying thing is that for nested loops, the planner estimate will not account for the actual loop. So if you have a nested loop join and you have two sequential scans, right? And this one says, I'm going to return three tuples. And this one says, I'm going to return six tuples. The other one is actually going to return 18 tuples because it's going to be rescanned three times. So what I did is I actually went in and accounted for that. So when I traverse the tree on nested loop nodes, I look at the inner child, take the estimate, and then I multiply everything in the outer child by the number of loops it estimates it will have to do. So at least that gives me a bit closer to reality than just using planner estimates. But so this is a quirk of how information is represented in the planner. I have specific code for nest loops, for merge join, and so on, but not for each and every weird node that's there. And I just assume that nodes that have more than two children are blocking and will drain them before progressing. So like if you have an append, it's gonna do that or not. If you have an append, it will not block. But if you have a union, it will. It will drain the inputs and then, actually, a union will usually insert hash nodes, and hash nodes will already give me what I want. But then it's just something to get this thing running. And some nodes, like recursive union, which is another node that can cause loops. So that's a good question. What kind of plan of execution nodes can end up increasing the loops number that you get from explain analyze? I asked this on IRC, and from reading the code, I thought the only way you can get something other than loops equal one is nested loops joins, rescans, and then Rhodium Tone said recursive union. And then I thought, recursive union, let's just not support that. So. So actually these are solutions-ish, and actually these are things that kind of work but can be improved, but still they work. There's a missing feature that the paper is really big on, and then they say it's quite important, which is refining the estimates as you go along. And this is a neat concept. For each node, let me bring back this. So for each node, you maintain two numbers, the minimum and the maximum number of tuples it will return. And you go about refining those as you go along. So Like, if I have a sort somewhere up there, I know that it will never return less tuples that have already been returned by its child nodes, right? So I can go in and push the lower boundary up, and there are the and you can like the upper boundary can also be pushed down in some right, like for sort, it's going to actually be exactly the number of the tuples returned by lower nodes, right? So it's like the basic idea is that you maintain these two numbers for each node, and then you never return anything from outside of the range of these numbers. And as you progress, you go, they come closer and closer and closer together. I haven't implemented that. They say it helps a lot. I can see why. You could add some smarts there, like saying, okay, I have a join on a non-null foreign key, so I know every tuple will have a counterpart, so it will return at least that many tuples as there are inner tuples, right? Or you can say, oh, it's a left join, so it's never going to decrease cardinality when you look at the inner child. It's only going to return as many tuples as the inner child returns, or more. So that's missing, and it should help, I guess. So where do we go from here? There are things that are just annoying and that just could be fixed, perhaps inside Postgres, perhaps inside the module, and there are things that are really difficult. So first of all, just identifying pipelines, like you said, well, will material start a pipeline or not? Is this a driver node or not? I don't have code for each and every node, and I haven't analyzed every node. So for some, I just assume, yeah, it has more than two inputs, it's going to be blocking. Yeah, it has one input, it's not going to be blocking. And so someone would have to go look through all these nodes and make sure the pipeline building code or detecting code is actually correct. It's not that easy to see if a pipeline started or finished, like I said. Because of rescans, because of a node being able to be executed multiple times, it's really hard to declare a pipeline finished. So that's even something as simple as that is not that straightforward. You don't get any visibility into sort nodes, and I'm not really sure how would you go about getting a number out of that, right? So you it's hard to say how far along a sort is. And since sort nodes are driver nodes, because they drain the input before they return tuples, this is kind of important. If you have a sort node, it's going to tell you zero until it starts outputting tuples. So I'm not really sure how you could see how far along a sort is. For instance, for hash, I actually go and look at the number of entries in the hash table, so I know how far along are we hashing, but for sort. It's using that shared memory trick of stashing stuff into shared memory and then other backends take it out. You need to signal the backend doing the work for it to give you estimates. So there's all kinds of security problems here. I haven't even started looking at this. I think it's only going to work if you're a super user, but I haven't really checked. But this is something that's fairly simple to improve once you know what you want to have. Rescanning is a whole other concept because, like you said, rescans can just blow your estimates out completely. Actually, materialization nodes, what they do is because they're not blocking, but if you ask for the same tuple again, it will not go down and ask for the child node for a tuple. It's actually much cheaper to loop over a material node than it is over a index scan node, right? If you have a nest loop join and the outer tree is an index scan, it will scan that index repeatedly. if you have a material node on top of that, the material node will retain tuples flowing up from the index scan, and the loops are going to be much, much cheaper. But nothing in here accounts for that. They just say, oh, it's going to be scanned a million times, so each of these two nodes is going to be run a million times. So that's the problem with materialize. You need to do that trick of walking the tree and manually multiplying by the number of tuples, where you rely on the planner estimate for the inner child, which can be wildly inaccurate. So that's annoying, because every change in the cardinality of the inner child in a nest loop node will make all the estimates for the outer node so much worse. But you could say this is a planner problem. I like doing that. If I'm doing something with the executor, I'm assuming the planner is perfect, and if something doesn't work, it's his fault. So if the planner gives me wrong data, it's like garbage in, garbage out. I don't care. The original paper doesn't account for that, which is understandable. I mean, I'm making fun, but you can't account for. I mean, I'm sure there are papers that build on top of that, and I'm sure these guys are way smarter than me, because they actually came up with all that, and I'm just picking on them because they haven't considered recursive union. So this is something. These are things you have to actually do yourself. There's a separate problem, which is the infamous single outer tuple, which means I have a nested loop, and the planner says that the outer, the inner node will return only one tuple. So it doesn't matter that it's a nested loop, because I will just fetch that one tuple and execute the whole outer subtree once, right? So there will be no looping, even though it's nested loop, because the driver node just returns one tuple. But then if it returns more than one tuple, everything goes to hell, right? Because you have to actually go and rescan this entire gigantic tree several times. If this happens, this means that the planner messed up by allowing this huge subtree to be rescanned. But this actually happens, and actually this can be very severe for the estimator, because it says, okay, you have one driver node, like, remember this? You have one driver node. Why would the planner do something as stupid as to make all this be rescanned? Why? Because this will just return one tuple. So even if it does return one tuple, it returns it, then you say, oh, cool, the driver node is done. But then work continues with all that. And as far as the pipeline is concerned, the driver node is done, and now it's just the aftermath. You just need to finish up the calculation, and you're done. You won't drive it more with more input from the driver node. But then it's not really what's happening, because the bulk of the work is spent here, and it's not accounted for at all. Some nodes break out from the getNext model. So like hash nodes don't return tuples. They build a hash table, and they return, I think they return null, and they just have the hash node inside. And then the parent node, knowing that they will find a hash node below them, grabs stuff from the hash. And there are comments there that say, don't worry about it. It's like, we really shouldn't, but then again, it's fine. Bitmap index scans are another funny beast, because they will scan the entire index. So they will drain the index, and then they will build up the bitmap, and it's not that easy to say how far along you are building that bitmap. So these nodes do not follow the getNext model, so they are directly not outside of what of the paper scope. If it happens that one of those is a driver node, the whole thing can kind of fall down. Then there are utility commands. So it's really cool to track the progress of a select, but what you also really would like is to track the progress of a copy or a create index, right? Especially when you're doing create index without concurrently, you want to know if this will be locked for a day or if it's going to be locked for 10 minutes. And as these are utility statements, they do not go through the executor per se. So there is no tree. Everything I said is a lie when you see one of those operations. So I think these could be worked around. So like a good estimator for Postgres would account for those by just having special purpose code for them. Like if you have a utility command, it's already handled by some special purpose code. You would add a special purpose code for estimating the progress. Like for create index, I think it would be quite easy to say how far along you are, like how much of the ration you're indexing have you scanned. For analyze, possibly too. For vacuum, yeah, I guess so. For copy, if you would somehow say, I'm copying X million rows, and then start the copy, you would see how far along are you. So I think you could try to have special purpose code for those. And so currently, the where we're standing, or where I'm standing with that, is it does some changes to core Postgres. We can't run it with unmodified Postgres, but they are not that controversial. So if we decide to run with that, I think we could sneak them in. The DNA kind of works. It's not bad. I mean, the progress bar I showed you at the beginning was impressive, right? But now you know it's not really good, but it was impressive. What it's doing now is it's returning float between 0 and 1, hopefully, and a dot, like graph viz file that I then use for these snapshot images. It's a way to start. It might be better to return like XML data, something like explain, and then an external tool could process this and give you a number or give you a dot file or whatever. So like I said, it might be better to return it in some other format, not sure. Estimate refining should be implemented because this should really help with some of the things. Because I mean the whole strength of this model is that the driver node is very well estimated because you usually quite well know how many rows will you scan when you're doing a sex scan, because you know the size of the relation, the width of the tuple, so that estimate is usually precise. And you can use that to kind of refine the estimate of the entire pipeline as it goes up. And this should be big. And for the time being, the code that's there in the repository is a total proof of concept. Do not run this anywhere. If you do, send me core dumps, because you will have core dumps, and I will fix them. But it was just a proof of concept to see what can we do. I mean, if the paper is even applicable and if it makes any sense to go in that direction. So we have a minute for questions. I'm sorry.
Would it be possible to put this into the statistics collector so you could, instead of having to signal it back in, you could get the data like from PGStat activity?
Yeah, I mean, PGStat activity is in shared memory anyway. So you could, yeah, thing is, the good thing about this is that you only get estimates when you want them. So when you ask for them, they get calculated. If not, the overhead is negligible. So that's why I went with the ask and go back. If you don't want to have it for each and every query, like if you're doing OLTP, it's overhead that you'd rather avoid doing all that calculation all the time. Yeah, something like that. Yeah. For instance, or like use a. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
If this happens again, I'll know that to check.
Well, there's some of that. There's a lot of queries around. I know they're going to run for a pretty long time. I mean, that's often knowable in advance. It's not a mystery. You look at the query and you're like, yeah, this is going to be a monster.
Yeah. I mean, if it's no LTP, And the overhead should not be big. I mean, the actual overhead of this, I haven't measured it, but it should be like in the low percent, 2%. It's nothing. It's just walking the tree and doing some simple calculations alone. It's actually, using this actually forces collecting instrumentation stats on the tree. So like if you do explain analyze, it will run the query a bit more instrumented than if you would run it without. So that's there, you pay that overhead. But if you could turn it on for queries you only care about, the overhead, like if it runs for 10 minutes, it's gonna be second or a second, like a fractions of a second, the overhead. Okay. Oh yeah. I mean, I wanted to minimize impact on core just to make it easier for people to try to run it, maybe on their home laptops with a copy of their production database or whatever. So I wanted to keep that small. So whenever I could, I would go around the executor. But if the executor could help extensions like that more than it does now. Okay, cool. Thanks.